The BCHA is one of the key sponsors of tonight's debate. It's the oldest and most democratic free thought group in this province. For over 25 years, we have represented and built a community for atheists, agnostics, and humanists. At this point, we are approaching a period of renewed growth. In the coming weeks, we will be hiring our first executive director, and we are hoping to gain recognition to perform the first humanist weddings in British Columbia. Our group is open and welcoming to all who want to help develop a community based on reason, compassion, and free inquiry. To find out more about us, you can visit our website at bchumanist.ca, or just find me later this weekend or tonight. I'll be hanging around. Tonight's debate is on the existence of God or gods, and while this question predates ancient Greece, I have faith that we're going to settle this tonight. Okay, it worked. All right. Arguing against the existence of God, right here we have Dr. Christopher DiCarlo and Matt Dillahunty. Dr. DiCarlo is an outspoken activist for freethought, humanism, and secularism. He is a fellow of the Society of Ontario Freethinkers and a board advisor to Freethought TV. He is also an advisory fellow for Centre for Inquiry Canada. Dr. DiCarlo was denied tenure at Wilfrid Laurier University after complaints from his students that his teachings were, quote, religiously insensitive. We'll see that tonight, I guess. Matt Dillahunty is president of the Atheist Community of Austin. Born a fundamentalist Christian for more than 25 years, his best efforts to become a minister backfired and gave birth to one of the most prolific voices on atheism of the past decade. Matt is also one of the co-hosts of The Atheist Experience, a weekly cable access show in Austin. And Wikipedia claims they have 760 episodes, but Matt tells me that's actually an exaggerated number. But the number of episodes he has starred in outnumbers the number of episodes of Friends that aired. You'll have to decide if he's Chandler, Ross, or Joey. Arguing for the existence of God is Michael Horner and Dr. Paul Chamberlain. Michael Horner is a philosopher with a Master's of Arts from the University of Toronto. He's a part-time instructor in philosophy at Trinity Western University, just down the road. In over 30 years with Power to Change Canada, Horner has participated in over 80 debates and delivered hundreds of lectures on Canadian and American university campuses in the defense of Christian truth claims. Dr. Chamberlain is the director of the Institute for Christian Apologetics at TWU. He has taught ethics, philosophy of religion, and Christian apologetics there since 1990. He has also worked with the Rabbi Zacharias International Ministries during part of his time. Dr. Chamberlain has appeared on numerous radio and television shows, debated on university campus, and is a frequent guest speaker at public functions. And finally tonight, our moderator will be Mel Rothenberger. Mel is the editor of the Daily News in Kamloops. He served as the mayor of Kamloops and chairs of just about everything, the school board, the Air Service Task Force, the Thompson Nicola Film Commission, the Graffiti Task Force, the Kamloops Tangal Friendship Committee, and the Task Force on the Sex Trade, among many others. Busy. But he's busier. He currently serves on the board of directors for the Kamloops Chamber of Commerce and the Kamloops Coordinated Environment Task Force. And he is the honorary chair of St. Andrew's on the Square 125th Anniversary Fundraising Project. Among his awards are the Queen's Golden Jubilee Medal, the BC Heritage Award, the Rotary International Paul Harris Fellowship, the BC Yukon Community Newspapers Association Eric Dunning Integrity Award, and the Jack Webster Foundation's Bruce Hutchinson Lifetime Achievement Award. Mel also blogs at The Armchair Mayor, and in a recent post yesterday, he talked about public prayers at public ceremonies, and he said, for my part, I'm a pacifist on such matters. My agnostic channeled self takes no offense to someone of faith expressing it at a public gathering, whether it be native elders thanking their creator or a service club member giving thanks to his God for lunch or dinner. I respect their right to believe what they want and to express it in a public way. At the same time, I trust they will not be offended if there are some in the room who don't share those beliefs and therefore don't feel inclined to stand and bow and close their eyes in homage to a higher being. So hopefully Mel will be an impartial agnostic sitting on the fence through this entire debate. I hope you enjoy tonight's debate with an open mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ian. You read that just exactly the way I wrote it. So thanks very much. Good job. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to moderate this very important question. Although I think, in my humble opinion, it's not the right question. Does a God or gods exist? I'm not even sure that's grammatically correct. But the real question should be, how do you find a place to park in downtown Kamloops? This one's important too, so we'll work our way through it and see what we can come up with. Ian has mentioned cell phones. I also need to mention washrooms. If you have to take a little break and go out there and you notice somebody in a white gown or a tuxedo, you're in the wrong washroom. There's a wedding going on down there. You want to use the washrooms just right out there. There's a big sign in the hallway. They're just outside the door and to the right. Now, I'm just going to introduce you to a little bit about how the evening is going to go, because there is a format to it. This is a debate. So we are going to begin with the affirmative or yes side of the question speaking, and the no side, in other words, no, there is no God or gods, will then have their turn to speak. Then they will rebut each other, then they will cross-examine each other, and then you will get your turn towards the end of the evening to ask questions, and following that, the teams will then have a chance to make a short closing remark on the evening. There's a very important rule that we have to abide by this evening, and that is to be sure that we treat each other respectfully and respond to the speakers in a respectful manner. It's quite all right to applaud them when they've completed their individual remarks, but interruptions and asides and that kind of thing are discouraged. We want to make sure that each is able to use his time as they see fit and to make their statements in a complete manner. The teams will act as a team. It'll be up to them between the partners in the team to decide how they use their time allotments. And one may speak more than the other, or one may speak on certain aspects of the question and the other on the rest of it. So that's just about all the rules there are. I'll explain the Q&A rules when we get there. And in the meantime, I think we need to get to the debate proper and tell you that the affirmative yes team will speak first, and they have a maximum of 20 minutes. They will be timed as we go along. We have a timer, and they'll have the benefit of a short warning when they get to the end of their time. So it's up to the team who speaks first, but would the yes team please lead us off?
Well, thank you so much, Mr. Moderator. I have to admit, I got dizzy hearing all the things you're involved in. I'm not sure if anybody else did, but I certainly did. I have been involved in my own community, on the school board, etc. I know a little bit of what that's like, but not to the degree you have. I thank you to all of you for coming, and good evening. I want to thank the Atheist Alliance International for organizing this forum. I also really want to thank the two gentlemen to my left who I've just met this evening, Matt Dillahunty and Dr. Christopher DiCarlo, for their willingness to enter into this exercise. I trust this will be a useful, enjoyable time of testing our convictions one against the other, and I always enjoy an intellectual exchange, and I'm assuming they do too, otherwise they wouldn't have gotten into their line of work. So we're gonna see how it goes tonight, but I want to thank them for it. There is a common assumption today that no thinking person could hold to a Christian theistic worldview. Well, the events of the last few decades show this is just not the case. Way back in 1985, there was a conference in Dallas, Texas, where Matt hails from, where over 200 scholars came from Europe, North America, all over the other countries as well. from a variety of disciplines, philosophy, the hard sciences, etc. The title of the conference was Modern Thought Turns to Atheism. And the point of the conference was to show that a growing number of scholars have come to see that their disciplines point to a personal God. In June of 2000, I was privileged to be part of a conference in Atlanta called God and the Academy, at which 400 scholars came together from North America and Europe and Canada. And the point of that conference was to show how Christian theism relates to different disciplines as well. Over the past few decades, key thinkers have been doing more of the same. Alvin Plantinga, very well-known Christian philosopher, is a committed theist, of course, written much in his defense, been the president, former president of the American Philosophical Association. Dr. Nicholas Wolterstorff, another past president of the American Philosophical Association, instructor at Yale University, a committed theist, written much in his defense. In the last 20 years, 25 years, two professional philosophical societies have sprung into existence, the Society of Christian Philosophers, the Evangelical Philosophical Society. At least 8 scholarly journals, philosophical journals, have risen up promoting the rationality of Christian theism, and we could go on and on and on with all that. The fact that I want to note, these facts do not constitute an argument for the truth of Christian theism. The fact that someone believes something does not make it true. However, they do dispel the false notion that belief in God is merely a matter of blind faith and no thinking person could ever adopt a Christian theistic worldview. So my question for us this evening is, why has there been this quiet revolution in rational theism? And even maybe the more pressing question, is it reasonable in today's world to believe God exists? Well, the question of today's debate, as the moderator has shown us already, is there a God or gods? And there, of course, there are 3 possible answers to that question. You can say yes, or you can say no, or you can say maybe, I don't know. The answer I'm going to give tonight, and Michael will as well, is yes. And we wish to defend 2 theses. The first one is there are no good reasons to believe God does not exist. And the second thesis is there are good reasons to believe he does. I'll take the first thesis, Michael will take the second. But let's look at that first one. There are no good reasons to believe God does not exist. You can't simply assume atheism. Why? Because it's a claim to know something. It's a claim to know God does not exist. And as such, it needs arguments. It needs proofs, justification of some kind in its support. Unless, of course, it's to be believed as a blind step of faith with no arguments. Anything other than that requires some kind of argument. Now, if you're going to assert there is just no evidence for God's existence that I find out there, and therefore God does not exist, then you've got quite a task. Because you'd have to, first of all, make sure that you refuted the arguments for the existence of God that have been put forward in order to make sure there is no good evidence out there somewhere. And I would note in this regard that philosopher Alvin Plantinga has written a very well-written paper entitled 2 Dozen or So Theistic Arguments. There are plenty of arguments out there. But not only that, you'd have to somehow get behind the known universe, the universe that science observes, and know that somehow, behind everything, somehow we know there is no divine power. I would say that probably requires omniscience. Of course, that's the ultimate letdown, if you find out you're the omniscient being when you're trying to figure that out. Now, of course, now some atheists will object at this point that it's impossible to prove a negative claim. That's just an unreasonable demand. You can't prove a negative claim, so you shouldn't be asking us to do so. I find that a very odd complaint. It's true, atheism is not only a negative claim, of course, but it's a universal negative. It claims to know that there is no God anywhere in or out of the universe. But the question I would then encourage all of us here to consider is that if you really believe atheism is that difficult to prove, then why do you believe it? And why encourage anyone else to believe it either? But secondly, let's just think about this. Is a negative claim really impossible to prove? Well, I think the answer to that is no, and we all know that. For example, very simple example, we all know square circles don't exist. How do we know that? Because we know that the very idea of a square circle is internally contradictory, therefore logically impossible. Therefore, we can confidently assert the negative claim that square circles do not exist. Interestingly enough for me, that is the very kind of reasoning that atheists often bring forward against theism when they produce the problem of evil. They use it to somehow show some internal inconsistency in the concept of God. There's one last way I'd like to mention before Michael comes that some atheists have tried to circumvent the whole problem of proving a negative, and that is arguing this way. We atheists really have nothing to prove because we really don't believe anything. It's only the theist who believes something, namely that there is a God. And therefore, it's only the theist who has something to prove. And then, of course, analogies are brought forward. Analogies like this, like the tooth fairy and the flying teapot and Frosty and Santa and the spaghetti monster. And the atheist will ask the question, because I say I do not believe in these beings, Does it mean there's some burden of proof on me to prove there is no tooth fairy, there is no Santa? Of course there's no burden of proof on me placed on me if I don't believe those. And neither is there burden of proof placed upon me if I believe there is no God. And no burden of proof placed on me to prove there is no God. Well, that's pretty ingenious reasoning. And at first glance, it doesn't sound too bad until you realize a couple of things. First of all, it is simply false to assert that the theist is the only one who believes something, only one making a truth claim, that atheism really believes nothing. It is true, theism does make a truth claim, namely God exists, but so does atheism. It makes a truth claim, God does not exist, a very significant truth claim. And I want to reiterate that every claim to know something requires reason or support to believe it, whether it be positive or whether it be negative. So then the question is, why does the reasoning appear to work with the tooth fairy or with Santa Claus? And the answer is this, that the atheist has very carefully chosen examples of things which are trivial, which are fun, which are mythical creatures, which never were intended to be taken as serious truth claims, so of course no one's asking for proof on them either way. But the atheist chooses these, and here's the point, atheist chooses these examples because the reasoning only works with examples like these. To see this, let's just substitute a normal, serious, negative truth claim and watch what happens to the reasoning. Suppose someone made this claim. I believe that pineapples do not exist. I believe Winston Churchill was never the Prime Minister of England. Or I believe 9/11 never happened. Or I believe the Holocaust never happened. How about that? And surely there's no burden of proof placed on me to prove these things don't exist or prove these events didn't happen because I don't really believe anything. Is there really no burden of proof placed on that person simply because the claim is negative? Of course there is a burden of proof placed on him. This person would have just as much burden of proof as the person making similar positive truth claims, and in some cases, possibly more. In other words, it is not the negativity of a claim that eliminates the burden of proof on it, but rather the triviality of a claim which does that. And that is because they were never intended to be taken seriously, and no one does take them seriously, so no one, of course, is asking for proof on them either way. So the examples work so long as they're trivial, which means the big question is the claim God exists a trivial claim? Well, if there's anybody who's not in a position to say it's trivial, it's atheists who travel hundreds and thousands of miles to come to a conference like this, or the new atheists who believe that belief in God is the cause of the world's greatest evils, and of course, others who write books and journals defending the claim, and others who have been willing to give their lives for this belief. This point is made very clear, in fact, by the atheist philosopher Kai Nielsen, who really, very frankly, honestly assessed the situation. He said this, if the arguments for the existence of God are shown to be unsound, it does not follow that God does not exist. To show that the proofs do not work is not enough by itself. It still may be the case that there is a God. And his point is this, if you're going to claim there is no God, in other words, if you're going to answer no to the question of today's debate, then you need your own independent arguments for your position. And today we're going to see what arguments Matt and Christopher will bring in support of their view that there is no God. Now Michael will come and present some arguments in favor of theism.
I too want to thank the organizers of this debate for inviting Paul and I to participate. And also want to thank Matt and Chris for their willingness to engage in an intellectual discussion like this. I think we are all going to enjoy this evening. Now let's consider our second contention, that there are good reasons to think that God exists. There's no shortage of good arguments for God's existence, as Paul said, but in today's debate we have time to briefly sketch out only three. One, God is the best explanation for the origin. Not sure why that's not advancing. That works. Okay, thank you, Chris. God is the best explanation for the origin of the universe. Have you ever asked yourself, why is there something rather than just nothing? Why the universe exists rather than just nothing? Well, typically atheists have said that the universe is just eternal and uncaused, but there are good reasons, both philosophically and scientifically, to doubt that this is the case. To have a universe that has always existed, you would have to have an actually infinite number of past events. But philosophically, the existence of an actually infinite number of things cannot exist in the real world. Like a library with an infinite number of books, it leads to absurdities and contradictions. Therefore, it logically follows that the past cannot be infinite. The universe had a beginning. Moreover, in one of the most startling discoveries of modern science, we now have incredibly strong evidence that the universe is not eternal in the past, but had a beginning about 14 billion years ago in the event that we know as the Big Bang. Now, what makes the Big Bang so startling is that it represents the origin of the universe from literally nothing. All matter and energy, and even space and time, came into existence simultaneously with the Big Bang. And since the formation of the standard Big Bang model or theory 83 years ago, all scientific attempts to avoid an absolute beginning to the universe have failed. In fact, in 2003, the cosmologists Bord, Guth, and Vilenkin proved that any universe that is on average in a state of cosmic expansion cannot be eternal in the past, must have an absolute beginning. Vilenkin, an atheist himself, was very clear when he wrote, "Cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning." Then just 4 months ago at a conference in Cambridge, in honor of Stephen Hawking's 70th birthday, Vilenkin presented another paper showing that the three latest alternative models of the universe cannot have an eternal past either. According to Vilenkin, all the evidence we have says that the universe had a beginning. Now, as one science writer put it, for Hawking, this must have been the worst birthday present ever. In his pre-recorded speech to the conference, Hawking specifically mentioned that if the universe had a beginning, or as he puts it, a point of creation, one would have to appeal to the hand of God. Well, how is it that the universe exists if there really was absolutely nothing? Being cannot come from non-being. Nothing comes from nothing. So the argument looks like this. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. Now, as the cause of space, time, matter, and energy, this cause must be a timeless, uncaused, changeless, spaceless, and immaterial being of immeasurable power. And being timeless and immaterial, it must also be personal, since only a transcendent personal mind or abstract objects like numbers could possibly be immaterial, but abstract objects cannot cause anything. Therefore, it follows that the cause of the universe is a transcendent personal mind. Two, God is the best explanation for the fine-tuning of the universe for intelligent life. In recent decades, scientists have been stunned by the remarkable discovery that our universe appears to have been fine-tuned with incredible precision for the existence of life. It appears balanced on a razor's edge. The numerical values of the different natural constants like gravity, electromagnetism, and subatomic forces, plus the arbitrary quantities just built in as initial conditions of the early universe, like the entropy level, they all just happen to fall within a very narrow range that is conducive for life to exist. Minute changes in any one of these values would have destroyed the possibility of life of any kind, and in most cases destroyed the universe. For example, if the force of gravity or the atomic weak force had been altered by as little as one part out of 10 to the 100th power, the universe would not have been life-permitting. Now, Hawking estimates that a decrease in the expansion rate of our universe of even one part in 100,000 million million, 1 second after the Big Bang, would have resulted in a universe collapsing long ago. And a similar increase in this speed of expansion would have stopped galaxies from forming. And no galaxies, no life. Now, this fine-tuning is beyond comprehension. The Oxford physicist Roger Penrose calculates the odds of the special low entropy condition of our early universe as having arisen by sheer chance as being at least as small as, now get a load of this number, one part in 10 to the power of 10, the whole thing to the power of 123. Well, how can values like this be explained? Well, there's only three possible explanations: physical necessity, chance, or design. Physical necessity means it had to be those values. It was physically impossible to be other than what they are. But it can't be due to physical necessity because the constants and the quantities in question are independent of the laws of nature. In fact, string theory predicts that there are 10 to the 500 different possible universes with different values compatible with this universe's laws. Richard Dawkins, Martin Rees, Even Hawking and Mladenov, in their recent book, all reject the hypothesis of physical necessity. So could the fine-tuning be due to chance? Well, the problem with this alternative, as we've just seen, is the possibility that all the constants and quantities would by chance alone fall into this life-permitting range is virtually zero. So we now know that if our universe were the product of chance, the odds are overwhelming that our universe should be life-prohibiting, not life-permitting like it is. So the argument looks like this. The fine-tuning of the universe is due to physical necessity, chance, or design. It's not due to physical necessity or chance. Therefore, it's due to design. Good. Thank you. Number three, God is the best explanation for objective moral values and obligations. Now, by objective, we mean true, valid and binding, whether anyone believes in them or not. That is true, independent of people's opinions. Just like 2 plus 2 equals 4 is objectively true, even if everyone in the world disagreed with it. Now, deep down, I think we all know that some objective moral values and obligations do exist. The judgments we make when ourselves and others are unjustly treated reveal what we really believe about morality, regardless of what we say we believe. I mean, we think that genocide in Rwanda, or the Nazi Holocaust, or raping little girls, or torturing toddlers for sport are moral abominations that people should not do. Not just some things that we don't personally, personally don't like, not just someone flouting social conventions. In fact, the most common response I hear from atheists to this issue is that, of course, torturing toddlers for sport is morally wrong. You don't need to believe in God to know that. And they're exactly right. You don't need to believe in God to know that objective moral values and obligations exist. But what if, in fact, there was no God? See, I find that atheists almost always misunderstand this argument that we're giving. They think it's claiming that the atheist can't be moral, but this is not what we're saying. The problem here is not the absence of belief in God, but the absence of God. In fact, if God, in fact, does not exist, what would make these moral values objectively true and obligatory on all people? If there is no God, it's difficult to see how there could be any objective foundation, any universal standard for good and evil. How do you get ethics from only different arrangements of space, time, matter, and energy, which is all you are left with if there is no God? Mr. Dillahunty was actually correct when he admitted in a recent debate, quote, "There is no good reason to believe that the universe is anything other than indifferent to our existence and our perceptions of good and evil," end quote. Moreover, human beings and human nature would be like everything else in the universe, just unguided, accidental arrangements of atoms. Therefore, there would be nothing objectively special or valuable about human beings that makes it mandatory that they should not be harmed. This is a serious problem for atheism. There's no way to get moral obligation, but that's what morality means. If you don't have objective moral obligation, you don't have morality. The atheist philosopher of science, Michael Ruse, makes clear the implications of atheism for morality when he writes, "Morality is just an aid to survival and reproduction, and any deeper meaning is illusory." However, if there is a God, he is by definition the greatest conceivable being. Because if there was a greater conceivable being, then that would be God. This is what philosophers mean by the term God. And this is not an assumption. We just arrived at it through reasoning. Furthermore, it is greater to be the paradigm of goodness than merely to be good or exemplify goodness. So God's nature must be the paradigm of goodness. It defines the good. So our moral obligations are determined by his commands, and his commands are expressions of his essentially good nature, the paradigm of goodness. You see, theism succeeds precisely where atheism breaks down. God's essentially good nature provides a foundation for the objective moral values and obligations, which the atheist just has to accept by faith. So formally, can I just finish with the argument here? 30 seconds? Thank you. So this final argument looks like this. God is, if God does not exist, objective moral values and obligations do not exist. But two, objective moral values and obligations do exist, therefore God exists. And we have three arguments wound together like a strong, like three cords of a strong rope for a powerful case for God's existence. Thank you.
Thank you very much to the yes side. If the speakers could just keep an eye on this young gentleman down here, and when he starts waving wildly, that means you're getting close to your time. So if we could just make sure that we stick to the time allotted, we will now go directly to the no side of the argument for their opening remarks.
Hey, I love being quoted correctly. But we'll get to that. Thanks everybody for coming out, and to the organizers, to both of you gentlemen for agreeing to do this, and to Dr. DiCarlo for agreeing to have me come in and join him when he wouldn't have needed any assistance, I don't think, but we'll have some fun with it. So we're here to debate the existence of God or gods, and we've been debating this question probably as long as we've been able to debate, and some would think that this fact alone is a compelling demonstration that those who would assert the existence of God have failed to make their case. I'm of the opinion that the portion of academia that has been called sophisticated theology is better labeled obfuscated theology. The arguments for the existence of God have all been heard before. I doubt we'll hear anything new tonight. Likely we may hear a new version of an old argument because we're quite skilled at finding ways of hiding the flaws in our attempts to lead the evidence where we'd like it to go, thus building new arguments from the carcasses of old arguments. And I admit that I find it curious that we're still debating this question in the 21st century, but I think it demonstrates that every new generation needs to be educated on the burden of proof and the rational justification for beliefs. So I'll spend a few minutes on that point. We tend to live our lives based primarily on inference and induction. Today is remarkably similar to yesterday. Dramatic changes either rarely occur or occur at timescales that are beyond our perception. And we build up an internal model of the universe based on the experiences we have. The information that we encounter adds to this, and we use this information to make decisions, and we are really, really good at it. We're so good at quickly processing information about our situation, making decisions about reality, that we often proceed without any deliberate thought. The situation is like that situation, this claim is like that claim, a quick visceral analogy, and we're ready to make a decision, and the decisions are almost always correct, or at least correct enough to be useful. This is a huge problem, because it causes us to overestimate our intellect, we overestimate our level of knowledge, and our ability to use deductive reasoning is poisoned by hidden biases, presuppositions, and misunderstandings. Magicians and con artists, like psychics, make their living off of this. There's another wonderful aspect of thought that I want to quickly address, and that's language. I don't think it's unfair to say that we're both really good at communicating and really bad at it. I'm willing to bet that with very few exceptions, everybody's understood the words that I've been saying without having to consciously, you know, what did he mean by that? I don't get it. We may do this for some specific words, but at this point in the talk, I've used hundreds of words, and nobody's really probably stumbled over it. Because of our reliance on inference and induction, our ability to communicate causes problems as well. Consider the question of this debate. Does a God or gods exist? Setting the grammar aside, and I think we can skip the first term without having some kind of Clinton-esque discussion about what does mean, but the second word or words are God or gods. And in most debates about the existence of God, we find the affirmative position arguing for a rather abstract deistic God. My point here is that most people have at least one God concept in their brain. Muslims will have a different God concept than Christians, yet they'll all rely on these same abstract arguments to attempt to confirm the existence of the God they believe in. So what we find is that the question often smuggles a lot of conceptual baggage that isn't necessarily justified by the particular usage of God. When we see an argument that concludes with, therefore God exists, the concept that is conveyed to some is, therefore, I'm justified in believing all the stuff I believe about Jesus or Muhammad or Allah or whatever. And that's simply not true. If an abstract argument for God can be used to lead to several mutually exclusive gods, there's a problem. The final term in tonight's debate is exists. And that's where I have the biggest objection. I've tried, but I can't think of a single topic outside of the issue of gods where the word exists means anything other than is real or manifests in reality. Yet in the debates about gods, there's often another usage of the word existence, something that's outside of space and time. This applies to cosmological arguments in particular. I don't know what it means to exist outside of space and time. I don't just mean that I can't conceive of its possibility. I mean that the notion is absurdly in contradiction with the normal usage of the word exist. Perhaps they're using exist in a new way, but I would think that maybe we'd have to find a new word for it. The curious thing about this is that what most believers that I interact with on the TV show or in email or at debates hold these two different ideas, both that their God exists outside of space and time and that their God interacts within reality. And that's actually a good thing. The good news is that we all necessarily must agree that we can only have a rational discussion about a God or gods that actually manifest in reality in some way that is detectable, because the existence of a non-manifesting or intentionally hiding God is indistinguishable from that God's non-existence. No argument alone can demonstrate the truth of the existence of a God. We must have evidence that supports the premises. In a valid syllogism, true premises necessarily lead to true conclusions. I don't expect debate opponents to present arguments that are invalid in form. I would hope that we've kind of graduated beyond that, but it could happen. Instead, I expect the discussions to focus on whether or not the arguments are sound, whether or not the premises are true. And there are a few important things to note. The first is that premises simply don't stand as true until someone demonstrates that they're false. That's a shifting of the burden of proof, which means that even if everyone continually fails to show that a premise is false, we're not one iota closer to demonstrating that it's true. The second is that you have to critically examine your intuitions about the premises to try to make sure that you're not smuggling in your biases or your presuppositions. Our reliance on inference allows us to hide our flaws, relying on just-so stories or things that simply feel true, and not being able to pick up on subtle differences in language. That's not a demonstration of the truth of the claims, and that's exactly what must be done to make the case. And speaking of making the case, you can look at all of this kind of as a court case. In a murder trial, the defendant is either guilty or innocent. That's just a fact about reality. But what we believe about those possibilities is the subject of the case. The jury isn't required to vote guilty or innocent. They vote guilty or not guilty. They're not addressing a question of innocence. They're addressing a question of guilt. A not guilty vote doesn't mean that the jury is convinced the defendant is innocent, though they might be. It simply means they're not convinced of the defendant's guilt. No one is going to take anyone to court to prove that they're innocent without an accusation of guilt in the first place, and nobody is going to defend the idea that I don't believe there's a God until it's been presented. I'm here tonight because I define the defendant, God, not guilty of existing. What sort of God would hide away such that a logical argument, which on its own can never confirm its existence, is the best case that one can present? What does it say about the state of theology if after all this time there's such a paucity of evidence that they must form and reform the same logical arguments designed to confirm the existence of the God that they already believe in? We're not having a debate tonight on the existence of quarks. But if we were, it's doubtful we'd be facing abstract arguments with ill-defined terms supported by no hard evidence. This is true whether we're talking about a God existing or aliens. This is why this debate has raged throughout history. This is why there is no Nobel Prize for discovering and proving the existence of God. We live in a universe where the following facts are, as far as I can tell, undisputed. People make mistakes. People are curious and seek explanations. People have continuously proposed magical explanations like God did it to fill in the gaps in our knowledge. People have invented gods for a variety of purposes, both as intentional frauds and mistakes. People believe this about every god except for the god that they believe in. The god claims can't all be right, but they can all be wrong. Inferring design does not confirm design. And none of these gods have ever been demonstrated to actually be existent. When a gap in our knowledge that was filled with God did it is investigated and a reliable evidence-based explanation has been found, that explanation has never been God did it. Given those facts, I'm tempted, to argue that one could be rationally justified in believing, though not claiming as certain, another red herring, that no gods exist. However, that's not what I'm required to do, just as I'm not required to prove my innocence if I'm the defendant in a murder trial, and I'm not required to prove that alien abductees are wrong. Suffice it to say that given the facts and the repeated failure to demonstrate a causal tie between a supernatural God and natural observations, I find that it is utterly irrational to conclude that a God does exist and that we should all find the defendant not guilty of existing.
Good evening, everyone. I wish to, as well, thank the organizers and my fellow debaters and Matt for coming to this event tonight. It is certainly a timely one. It's one that has been discussed considerably for millennia, I would say. One of the things I'd like to discuss tonight is to follow up with Matt's particular point. I'm going to try to use this, see if it actually works for me. Or not. It has a kind of a range of about 4 inches. I'm just going to let Matt advance it. So to get right to the point, since Matt's introduced essentially a meta-analysis of some of the epistemic parameters surrounding tonight's debate, I'll further this approach by considering some other key components. So what are epistemic parameters? Epistemic is the Greek term which refers to knowledge. The Greeks, as well as many other societies, were interested in what we can know. What are the limits of my knowledge? It's one of the big five that I talk about in the book. How do we know what we know, and what gets to be considered knowledge? And this could be the most important question we can ask ourselves, because in determining what counts as knowledge, we have to be very careful in what we put forward. And so there are rules to what can be said and what cannot be said. And there are devices, things like logic and language and human reason, and the capacity to convince people based on the soundness of your ideas. So whenever I use the term epistemic, it refers to knowledge. So epistemic parameters are what shape and influence and constrain our understanding of the world, the physical world. So first, judging by the biographies of Mr. Horner and Dr. Chamberlain, and having heard their opening statements, it's really no mystery that they do believe in a very specific type of God. So when we talk about does God exist, we have an idea of what it is we're going to be discussing and disputing and dialoguing and debating tonight. So we're not going to be discussing the existence or non-existence of Zeus or Thor or Agamemnon, Bacchus or Quetzalcoatl, or any of the hundreds of gods which have been invented throughout the fairly recent past. Although I do maintain that their version of God and Jesus Christ possesses the exact same amount of reality and conviction as all of the other gods worshipped, loved, feared, respected, and reviled. So I don't think there's any difference in whether or not when we talk tonight about does God exist or not, we could be having the same dialogue about Zeus. Or any of the other gods throughout history, they will try to convince us that their particular version of God should be accepted based on the soundness of their reasoning and the cogency of their premises. What I'm going to try to do, and what I believe Matt also has in mind, is to demonstrate that they do not possess the capability to do this. Otherwise, we would all be Christians. Not just any Christians, but exactly the same type of Christians as they are, because that would follow. Now, when we ask about whether or not a god or various gods exist, let us be clear that we are debating the existence of this very specific god. So we are talking about the God of Christianity tonight. Now, although this narrows our focus a little bit more sharply, it creates a whole new set of problems because it raises questions about, whose interpretation of this particular God should we accept and why? Mr. Horner, Dr. Chamberlain are quite convinced that their understanding and belief in a Christian God is the absolute truth. And this poses quite a bit of a dilemma. Either they are correct, and Matt and I are currently incapable of seeing this absolute truth, or they only think they possess absolute knowledge of the existence of such a being, and the information they believe to be the truth does not actually correspond to reality at all. If the former is the case, then they should be able to convince not just Matt and myself, but every single person in attendance here tonight and residing on this planet. In all of the debates I've been involved in, this has never been the case. But I remain hopeful. I must confess, there is a part of me that is hopeful that Mr. Horner and Dr. Chamberlain, I think it would be a tremendous accomplishment if they could prove absolutely and without doubt the existence of the particular God that they happen to believe in. We all leave here saying, imagine religion. Jeez, we were wrong. I have absolute truth now. But I'm not going to get my hopes up too high. Not just yet. Socrates and the ancient skeptics were very adept at demonstrating the shortcomings of any such claims. And I intend to carry on this tradition and keep the burden of proof squarely where it needs to remain. And that's with those who make the extraordinary claims, right? They need to provide extraordinary evidence tonight. For as it turns out, invariably, the evidence of a Christian God is not only not extraordinary, it's fraught with too many inconsistencies and contradictions to be convincing or acceptable. So, now I'm going to look at what I call an ontological disjunct, and I hope this sets the theme for tonight's debate. So, this is what I call an ontological disjunct. If you look at it, UI or not UI, this is just logical notation, which means the universe was either intended or not intended. Now, although we can easily imagine an unintended universe to have come into existence, and ironically, on Sunday, Lawrence Krauss is going to discuss how this is possible, the most diplomatic and responsible thing to do is to bracket this disjunct and put it off to the side. Then we can get on with the big business of figuring out how it is we're all going to get along. So this incorporates a bottom-up approach, which starts with an admission of ignorance. And this then allows us to move away from this disjunct and find ways to increase the betterment for humanity and other species as well. However, instead of bracketing this disjunct, Mr. Horner and Dr. Chamberlain do the following. They not only choose one side of the disjunct, that is to say, the universe was intended, but then they call this intender God, and then they go about attributing all kinds of features and attributes and commands and descriptions and so on and so forth to further describe what this particular intender intends. Although we can easily imagine this unintended universe, what happens here is instead of judging and suspending judgment and bracketing this particular disjunct, our opponents have not only chosen this, but they proceed to add a great string of conjuncts in the form of qualities and commands and descriptions. In other words, they claim to know with absolute certainty that there is a creator, and it is all-powerful, and all-knowing, and all-present, and all-good, and it created humankind, and it told humankind what constitutes the world, and it told mankind how to act, behave, and it gave to mankind its only son, and so on and so on and so on. These are called conjuncts. Do you remember conjunction, junction? What's your function? A conjunct, and, but, and, or. To this day, I remember that because of that. But what I'm talking about are all of the ands that their God has. Now, this is clearly a form of fallacious reasoning because it violates Occam's razor. That is the principle that one should not add conjuncts, entities, beyond necessity, especially when faced with such an obvious admission of ignorance. To end this debate right now, all we need to do is have both sides admit that neither really knows for sure whether any God exists or not. Because neither of us knows. I don't believe there is. Matt doesn't believe there is, but they do. One side insists not only that they can know a specific God exists, but that all of the qualities and attributes that that particular God possesses. And this is why they will lose tonight's debate. For although I shall not attempt to prove a negative, i.e. that no God exists at all, and that's what it means to prove a negative, I will do my very best to find problems with the conjuncts of Mr. Horner and Dr. Chamberlain and how they have strung it. So please keep in mind, the more conjuncts they add to God, the more likely it is for Matt and I to find unresolvable tensions, inconsistencies, and contradictions. And this is what we will focus on during the rebuttal. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And those are our opening remarks from the two teams. Now, during dinner, there was a bit of a debate going on. A couple of the speakers wanted to have 10 minutes for rebuttals, and the others wanted 15 minutes. So we settled on 12 minutes, which shows you that there is room for compromise here tonight. So we will have 12 minutes for each team to construct their rebuttals, and we will go back to the yes team to begin.
Well, thank you very much. Let me just say there's a few things that stand out in my mind about the speeches I've heard tonight from Matt and Chris. The first one is rather striking to me, and that is that with the entire 20 minutes that they've taken, there has not been even one attempt to make even one argument or one reason to believe atheism is true. I'm not sure if the rest of you picked up on that, but that stands out to me as starkly as anything. Not even one. And I'm really quite amazed at that, and there's still time to go in this debate, and I want to hear if they come up with an argument, because I really would like to hear one, and it's difficult to respond to an argument when there is none. Nothing was said to respond to the arguments Michael Horner put forward, and that's worth noting as well. We heard about things like distant decision-making process and overrating our intellectual abilities, which, of course, we're all prone to do that, and smuggling and baggage and inferences, and I know, well, that's always a danger. Everybody's got to watch that. But the couple of things that were said were of interest to me about the way the reasoning has gone forward by both the other debaters here. Matt mentioned the meaning of existence, existing outside of time and outside of our present reality. And Matt mentioned, I got no idea what it means. To me, that's just irrational to think of some being existing out there. Well, let me just say, the fact that Matt does not know what it would mean, what it would be like to exist outside of time or reality, does not mean it can't be done. The question is there some kind of logical impossibility, some kind of impossibility logically, with an infinite transcendent being existing out there somewhere who might choose to reveal himself to us? Is that logically impossible? Is there some reason why that couldn't be? That's the only question that really matters here, not whether some of us find it amazing and mysterious and astonishing. Most Christians do as well. The question is there anything logically impossible about it? I see none that there could be. Matt then got into the issue of the burden of proof, which I'm glad that he did. That's a very important part of our debate here tonight. Mentioned that every claim needs evidence. I agree. I was totally in agreement with that. seems to assume something very interesting, though, which I've never really heard in quite the same way, but I've heard it tonight from both of the debaters on these ones to my left here, and that is that if the arguments for theism were true, catch this, if they were true, then what would follow from that? Everybody would then be Christian. Everybody would be a theist. Is that true? Think about that. If the arguments for theism were successful, is that how you measure it? That everybody would then be convinced by them? Have you ever heard of an argument which is logically valid? In other words, the premises are true and the conclusion follows from the premises, and yet somebody out there somewhere doesn't see it and doesn't agree to it. Ever heard of that? They see, this is a really key point in the reasoning here tonight, and they both made it. Christopher went all the way. He said, otherwise we'd all be Christians. Everybody on the planet would be. He's kind of hopeful that that might happen, maybe even here tonight. I am not sure if it'll happen here tonight. I'd be thrilled if it would. That's what he said. I just got to say, that is not how you measure or evaluate the logical validity of an argument, by how many people are convinced. It's possible to have an argument which is logically valid, premises are true, and yet nobody believe it. That's possible. Okay, so you can't measure any good argument by saying how many people believe it. If not everybody believe it, something's wrong with it. You can't do that. That's not how logic works, not how arguments work, and I think we all know that. Interesting reasoning by Matt at the end. Talked about a variety of ideas about God, some very bizarre, and of course, who doesn't know that? I know that, we all know that. Therefore, there again, he made the statement, I find it irrational to believe in God when there's so many different ideas out there and so many claims about what God told me to do this or that. My question is, I know all that's true. My question is simply this, what follows from all that? We gotta ask that question. What follows from the fact that there are different ideas about the nature of God and people make different claims about God? I don't even know what follows from that. Does it follow that there is no God? Does it follow that it's irrational to believe there is some God out there? How does that follow? There's a lot of logic going on here tonight I think we need to check ourselves on. The bottom line point I'd like to make here is I tell my students all the time, you cannot judge a viewpoint by its abuse or by its neglect. You cannot judge a viewpoint that way. One point I want to make, and then I'll turn it over to Michael to finish the rebuttal time, and that is that Christopher mentioned something about an unintended universe, made a statement which actually surprised me. Said, we actually cannot know. And he said, I wish those two guys down there, pointing to Michael and me, would just admit that none of us really knows. Well, the word know is a very interesting term. Epistemology is a very important philosophical study, and you need to define a term like know. It usually means justified true belief. It's possible to know something without having absolute certainty on it, because he threw the word absolute up there to confuse matters as far as I'm concerned. To know something doesn't necessarily mean having whatever he means by absolute knowledge or whatever that would mean. Justified true belief is the long-time definition of knowledge. And all I would say here is, if Christopher is willing to say here today, I don't really know whether or not there is a God or whether or not the universe is intended, then I want to probe a little further as we get going on about what his position really is and which position he's really advocating tonight. Because remember, there are three answers to the question in tonight's debate. One is yes, is there a God? One is yes, that's the theist answer. One is no, that's the atheist answer. And the third one is what? I don't know. And that's what I heard from Christopher, at least. I'm not sure if Matt would hold the same position, but that's what I heard. And if that's the case, then there's two things interesting about that. That undermines atheism, because atheism answers no, agnosticism answers maybe. And secondly, I wonder if we've ever considered, I wonder if Christopher has considered, what it would take to actually prove and support a statement like that. We cannot know whether or not the universe is intended. See, that's a classic statement of a position called dogmatic agnosticism, which says we cannot know whether or not there's a God up there who may have chosen to reveal himself to us. We cannot know that. Well, to support that, you would have to know this, that if there was a God there, and Christopher's position does allow that possibility because we cannot know, if there was a God there, somehow we know this. He either could not or would not choose to reveal himself to us, and somehow we know that. That's what you'd need to know to support that statement. We cannot know whether or not the universe is intended. I'm not sure how anybody could support that apart from an omniscient being. So I'm going to probe Christopher a little further on. We'll talk about it together and maybe privately after on that position, because I'm intrigued by that. Thanks, and I'll turn it to Michael here.
I think I can give you a summary of my of my rebuttal by three words. One, demonstrate absolutely. I guess that was two words there. Conjuncts, and three, hiddenness of God. So one, certainty. Both speakers basically said that we have to demonstrate, those are Matt's words, we have to show absolutely without doubt that God exists. Where did this standard come from? This is not a standard that anybody uses, ever. They certainly, I mean, Christopher certainly isn't using it for his position, which his position, as Paul just said, is that nobody knows. Well, can he demonstrate that without doubt, absolutely? No, this is just not the way philosophical arguments work. We don't apply it to every other part of our life. All of science is probability. Most what we know, we do not know with certainty. In fact, there's hardly anything we know with certainty. Maybe some mathematical axioms and even mathematicians disagree about that. What we know probabilistically. That's the type of universe that we live in, through induction, but even through deduction. The premises in a deductive argument may be supported to give us a certitude of only probability, not absolute certitude. But it's still a good deductive argument, because the premises only have to be more likely true than their denial. Especially tonight, the denial of God's existence. We only have to prove that it's more likely true that God exists than the denial. We do not have to prove that it's absolutely certain. So the standard is completely wonky here, is not applied to any other part of their life, either personally or professionally, and it's set a ridiculous, irrational standard that can't be met. We are providing probabilistic arguments that are in the form of, I gave two forms on purpose. Abductive, God is the best explanation for X, but I also ended it with a deductive format. And so if they are going to deny that these produce the conclusion God exists, they have to show what's wrong with the argument. You can't just a priori say these arguments just don't ever work. So I look forward to hearing what's wrong with the specific premises in these arguments. The arguments are sound. What premise do they think is mistaken, and why? And as long as that premise is more likely true than its denial, then it is a good argument. Secondly, conjuncts. Chris was concerned about the attributes that we're adding to the conclusion. But notice these are not just being added arbitrarily. They flow from the arguments themselves. The three arguments that I gave cause us to draw the following conclusions: that there's a cause and designer of the universe that is intelligent, personal, good, immaterial, changeless, spaceless, uncaused, enormously powerful being that existed in a timeless state beyond the beginning of the universe and then existed within time with the creation of the universe. Now, this is a being that is consistent with the Judeo-Christian concept of God. These attributes flow necessarily from the arguments. They're not just arbitrary. And even if we do not show a whole bunch of other attributes of God, some of which Chris mentioned, if we are successful, this is a remarkable conclusion that we've shown that a being like this most likely exists, and it's consistent with the Judeo-Christian concept of God. This is a remarkable conclusion, one that people leaving tonight would not be able to just ignore. You should not be able to ignore that. You can't say, oh, well, you didn't prove all of the attributes of God. Hey, there's only so much time in a debate. We've proved an awful lot, I believe, with these three arguments, and it is significant. Paul, can you bring up slide 83, see if this will work for us? This is about the hiddenness of God. Let me just read this here. There is no reason to believe to think that God would want persons to believe that he exists and the gospel message is true if he also knew these persons would not respond affirmatively to it. It's plausible that for this reason, God has given sufficient evidence for those with a genuinely open mind and heart, yet vague enough so as not to compel those or coerce those whose hearts and minds are closed. God does say that if we seek him with all of our heart, we will find him. Thank you.
Thank you. No side rebuttal. 12 minutes.
So I apologize. This is going to be fast. Dr. Chamberlain's right. Just because I don't believe something doesn't tell you whether or not it's true. So is there actually a logical problem with something existing outside of time? I'd say yes, that there is. And that is that existence, by definition, is necessary temporal. It doesn't make any sense to say something exists for 0 seconds or negative 2 seconds. And I think that that's a pretty compelling reason to stop at least using the word exist if you're talking about something that exists outside of time. Atheism doesn't answer the question of existence with no. Atheism answers the question of belief with no. Do you believe a God exists? This is why I use the courtroom analogy in particular, because I'm not necessarily able to assert the defendant's actual position because I'm not omniscient. And so I'm sorry that Dr. Chamberlain doesn't like the fact that atheism is not, as he defined it, this assertion that no, there is no God. It is the rejection of theistic claims. Why believe something that you can't prove is something that he asked initially. Well, I think it's based primarily on the misdefinition of atheism, because I don't. I actually strive not to believe things that I can't prove. And what I believe with respect to God is that the burden of proof for the existence of God has not been met, and that's the case that I would attempt to make. No, this idea that he seems concerned with, that no thinking person could be a Christian, that this is out, I don't know where this came from. I've never thought that, because I was a thinking person and a Christian for 25 plus years. My position is that I would say that no rationally justified thinking person could be a Christian, because I wasn't, and I don't think they are, because they haven't demonstrated the justification for the existence of God. Every claim needs support, he said. Yeah, but there's also this thing called the null hypothesis. There's a difference between X is false and X is not true. And the null hypothesis that you could view as sort of a default position, the fact that its strength is in the fact that it could never be proved. And so we begin with something, I would assert, that the atheist position, that belief in God is not rationally justified, is the null hypothesis, and that the theistic claims need to overcome that. This idea about absolute certainty is a big fat red herring. I've railed against absolute certainty so many times on the show, saying that it doesn't apply to anything outside of logical absolutes and esoteric claims and labels. It's not relevant here. My definition of even knowledge, even if I were to assert that I know no gods exist, would not in any way touch on absolute certainty. There's another thing that Dr. Chamberlain mentioned, which is that the triviality of claims eliminates the burden of proof. I've never heard anything more absurd. There's nothing gets rid of the burden of proof, no matter the claim. If you assert a positive claim, the burden of proof is on you to present it. It doesn't matter that it's a tooth fairy or Santa Claus. Trivial claims may not be as vigorously pursued because they're trivial, but it doesn't eliminate a burden of proof if your goal is to convince someone that you're actually correct. This last thing about God being the best explanation for things, the God hypothesis has no explanatory power. At all. We tend to explain things in terms of other things that we understand. You can crack the mic. You cannot solve a mystery by appealing to a bigger mystery.
Excuse me, how much time do we have? It's okay. So, Dr. Chamberlain had talked about that there is no good reason to believe God does not exist, and there are plenty of good reasons to believe that such a God exists, and that an atheist must refute arguments for a Christian God. We can certainly put forward an awful lot of refutations and inconsistencies, which we will do more than likely in the cross-examination. There are plenty. What I have found most interesting so far is a glaring lack of honesty, and there's a certain disingenuous nature with our debaters who are talking about God in kind of an abstract way. And then if you catch it, and if you've been looking carefully at the slides and listening very carefully, there'll be God, and then there'll be God in the Gospels, and there'll be God in Jesus Christ. And it'll be very kind of, you know, in there so that you don't notice it. What we're lacking here is, how do we get from this nebulous concept of a God, whatever that could mean, to the actual beliefs in a being like Jesus Christ? That has not been demonstrated. And these gentlemen define themselves as Christians. They talk about us not being able to have proven atheism. Atheism is basically the opposition party. You make the claims, we can demonstrate why it is your claims are not to be accepted. We don't necessarily have to prove our point. And as I have said earlier, when talking about the concept of certainty, it is such an elusive concept in terms of what can and cannot be known. It defies my recollection of how they can get up every morning and do believe in the absolute truth of their particular being, that is the creator of all the universe, and so on and so forth. So when it comes to statements like God is the best explanation of the origin of the universe, now, just because the universe may have had a beginning does not mean it had to have been caused by a particular being. As Lawrence Krauss points out in his latest book, there are ways to conceive of a universe coming from nothing. The medievals called this nihil ex nihilo. Nothing can come from nothing. But that's an Aristotelian notion of causality. Once you step into the shoes of a quantum physicist, that changes. Bizarre things happen in the quantum world. And so they must come into that world to be able to have meaningful dialogue about how it is, in fact, possible for all of this to have come from nothing. And so to say just because there was a beginning to the universe, they want to use a medieval argument, this Aristotelian notion, you know, the Kalam argument that William Lane Craig uses over and over and over again, which is a bad argument. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe had a cause. Craig, like Aquinas, wrongly assumes in this Aristotelian notion of cause and effect. And I think that severely limits their understanding of how it is possible. I think they're limiting themselves in exercising imagination and understanding and tolerance to try to consider how scientists can actually conceive of a universe coming from nothing. In terms of the fine-tuning of the universe, that the universe could not be as it is now unless something was tinkering with it, is known as the anthropic principle, the strong anthropic principle. But what we're finding now is the possibility of multiverses. We're talking about the possibility that there could have been millions of failed universes in the past. This just happens to be the universe that succeeded. It doesn't necessarily mean it's because it got a push from a big god, or a jump start, or a kickstart, or anything like that. It just may be one of an indefinite number of universes that are existing alongside of us. So when he talks about the idea of physical necessity, chance, and design, you know, even if this were true, right, that some type of nebulous god jump-started the universe, some deistic entity that no longer cares about us now, it in no way would ever indicate that leads to something like Jesus Christ and then everything that we find in the Bible. Why wouldn't we then believe in Brahma or Allah or read other sacred texts? Why does it have to be a Christian-defined God? That hasn't been demonstrated at all tonight. In fact, that's been left out of the picture, and I find that extremely disingenuous for a debate in which they're trying to demonstrate that such a being does exist. And I have no reason to accept any of their premises so far. Mr. Horner talks about objective morality, the idea that you cannot have morality without a particular type of deity. I find this to be extremely lacking, because let's do a thought experiment. Let's imagine, for the sake of argument, that there is no God, there's never been a God, there never will be a God. How has that changed history? How has that changed the way in which you've acted, will act, and the rest of the world is going to act? Because here we all are. And their apparent supposed God has had no influence in any way, any real way, over how we've behaved towards each other. We can pretend that such a being exists, but we have no definitive proof. And we certainly don't have probabilistic proof. I don't even know that, what that would mean, that it would be more probable to believe in this particular type of God than not to believe in that, because we have no basis of point from which to measure the probability of that claim. So it's an empty and meaningless claim. As for the ontological argument, for those of you who are wondering about that, that God is the greatest possible thing that can be conceived, it would not be as great of a being if it didn't exist, therefore it must necessarily exist, I can use to think of the greatest possible banana in the world. Just imagine the greatest conceivable banana in the world, or octopus. Such an octopus would not be as great if it did not exist. Therefore, the Myers octopus actually has existence. You can use it for anything. It's easy, but it doesn't prove it. You can't just use logic to bring things into being. As Jean-Luc Picard said, thinking something doesn't make it so. Right? So, I think I'll leave off with a Star Trek reference.
Now, the next segment, which is the one before we turn it over to you for some questions, on CBC's Debaters program would be called the Bare Knuckle Round. Tonight, it's called the Cross-Examination. And the way it works is this, that first the yes team and then the no team will have 10 minutes to ask the other team questions and receive answers. And that 10 minutes is totally within the control of the team. They can take as long or as short a time to ask the question as they want, and if they don't like the answer they're getting, they can cut the other guy off and move to the next one. So it should be pretty neat to watch. So 10 minutes for the bare knuckle round or cross-examination, beginning with the yes team.
Okay,
and they will remain seated, by the way, for this part.
All right, is this microphone going? Yeah, okay. I'd like to come back to something Matt keeps referring to, Matt, on the burden of proof. Did I hear you correctly? You said burden of proof is always on the positive. You had never heard anything quite as absurd as the idea that you can talk about things being trivial, and that's only the only reason why people don't ask for burden of proof. Burden of proof is always on the positive. Is that your position?
Yes.
Well, then what if a person did come to you and say, you know, I really don't believe the Holocaust happened?
Okay.
Is there no burden of proof on that person to prove that? Yes or no?
If their actual claim is, I do not believe the Holocaust happened, then no, they're not assuming
no
a burden of proof. If they're trying to convince someone else that the Holocaust did not happen, that's a different issue.
Okay,
there's a difference between I don't believe.
Okay, so you got something going here. You got an interesting thing going here. I think you're trying to have it both ways, if I could say that the way maybe a Texan would say it. You're saying that to hold the position, no burden of proof, but to convince somebody of it.
No.
Okay, what are you saying?
I'm saying there's a difference between I don't believe the Holocaust happened.
Yeah, and there's no burden of proof on that?
No.
No burden of proof.
Can I answer it?
Yeah.
There's a difference between I don't believe X.
Yeah.
And I believe X is false. Those are
right.
Two different positions. One of them is a state of not being convinced of the truth of something,
right.
And the other one is the state of being convinced that the claim is false.
Okay, so let me cut in there. That's perfect then. So if the person who says, I believe X is false.
Yes.
That person has a burden of proof?
Yes.
So the person who says, I believe there is no God.
Yes.
That person has a burden of proof?
Yes.
Well, then you do have a burden of proof placed upon
you.
Did
I say, I believe there is no God?
I think so. Because tell me this. There's three answers to the question of tonight's debate. There's three answers to the question of tonight's debate.
Okay.
Is there a God? One says yes. One says, I don't know. One says, no, there is no God.
Yep.
That seems to me that's the atheist position. I'm just for interest's sake.
No, that's not the atheist position.
Let me read you the Encyclopedia of Philosophy. According to the most usual definition, an atheist is a person who maintains there is no God. That is, the sentence God exists expresses a false proposition. And I could give you a Bertrand Russell who made it really clear. He said the atheist is the person who knows the claim God exists is false. Mm-hmm. Theist is the person who says he knows that the proposition God exists is true. The agnostic is the person who withholds judgment. So your position is just what? You do not believe there is a God, or you believe God, there is no God?
Well,
do you believe there is no God, yes or no?
What? Yes.
Yes, you believe there is no God.
Yes, but what I believe is independent of what atheism is or isn't, and I disagree with Russell's assessment of it, and I think most of the atheists that I interact with, maybe this is a new atheism thing, although I think that's kind of a stupid label to put on it, yeah. But by and large, this is the position. Now, do I actually believe that there are no gods? Yes. Now, the question, I guess, is whether or not there's any certainty there.
Well, okay, that's okay. Burden of proof is, I'm only asking because here you are tonight. You're doing more than just standing up here and saying, I want to let you folks know I don't believe there is a God. You're up here for 10 minutes telling us why we should also believe there is no God.
No.
And you're not doing that.
No, I'm up here explaining why you should also not believe there is a God. I'm representing the atheist position, not the anti-theist position.
Exactly, and I'm only asking this. Are you giving any reasons to anybody as to why they should consider that proposition to be correct, that there is no God? That's my question.
I just said that's not what I was defending the atheist position, not the anti-theist position.
Okay, so what we got to make real clear here is that there's not even an attempt on your part to give a reason to believe there is no God.
Correct.
All you think you need to do is to try to show us that the arguments for God fail. And
yes.
I think you need to go back and look at Kai Nielsen, who made it really clear, logically speaking, it may be the case that all the arguments fail and there still is a God.
And I don't care what Kyle Nielsen said
either. But you must know that's true.
It doesn't matter to me what these other atheist authorities say.
Okay, but you must know it's true that even if the arguments for God failed, it still could be the case that there is a God. You must know that's true. Exactly. So then the question is, why should anybody think there is not one? That's my question. Why should
the fact that there could possibly be a God is not a compelling enough reason to think that it's actually true. So while I admit that there may possibly be a God, I not only don't believe there is one, but I believe there's not.
Okay, okay, that's good. You're pretty well there. So what I'm basically hearing, I think, is a conflating of two positions, which I really become pretty much accustomed to in these kind of interchanges, that a person comes out claiming to be an atheist, but when it comes to defending the position, you defend agnosticism. You don't defend atheism, and I think that's what you're doing here tonight, and giving us a reason for saying you don't need to defend atheism. That's what I'm hearing. But hey, we can talk about it more privately.
Well, what you're hearing isn't necessarily true, just like what I believe isn't necessarily true.
Yeah, but is that not correct? You're not willing to give us any reason for believing atheism is true. No one here will hear that any reason for you from you
the,
on
the
that tonight.
The proposition atheism is true is an absurdity. I'm not here to present the case for anti-theism. I was here to defend the case for atheism, which is the rejection of theistic claims, not the negation of theistic claims.
But I don't think you give any reason arguments for it, and you're admitting you haven't, and you're admitting you don't have to.
That's what you heard.
Well, I think that's what you just told me.
Let's get to the arguments for God and your responses to them. Let's start with the last one. If there is no God, how do you avoid moral nihilism? For either of you, if there is no God, if God does not exist, how do you avoid moral nihilism?
And for the purpose of clarity, if you'd quickly define moral nihilism.
Okay, moral nihilism, that there is no objective morality, no objective good or evil, right or wrong.
Even if there is objective morality, I can't claim that I know what that is. What I can do is try to figure out what is in the best interest of my species, other species, and so on, according to my current level of value system at this given time in history. That's about the best.
All right. Do you agree with premise number two of the moral argument as I presented it, that objective moral values and obligations exist?
I can't say show me one, I guess, and maybe...
Torturing toddlers for sport is wrong?
I don't know if that's an objective truth. If by objective truth, what do you mean?
Objective, it's true independent of people's opinions. Just like 2+2=4 is true even if the whole world disagreed, it's objectively true. Is it also the case that torturing toddlers for sport is morally wrong is objectively true?
It's certainly something I find abhorrent, something I would not take part in. Your notion of objective truth?
So you're not...
Where does that exist in reality? There, if all of what you see before you now, as I maintain, is the result of accidental forces,
right,
then our values are constructs.
That's right. Well, you're exactly right. If atheism is true, that is what you're left with, which is moral nihilism, the lack of objective truth. So my initial question was, how do you avoid moral nihilism? And you basically have basically shown that you don't. You've actually sunk right into it, and you're quite happy there.
Why do you need objective truth to be a good person?
Boy,
I think
I'm not sure you understand the meaning of the word objective. Why do you need objective truth to be a good mathematician? 2+2=4 is objectively
morality
true.
Morality and mathematics are not the same. That's known as a fallacy of
the objective. No, but the objective.
Well, yes.
The sense of objective is true. It's true independent of people's opinions. So you haven't avoided moral nihilism. Now,
I've avoided it?
You haven't avoided it.
Oh, I haven't avoided
you,
it.
You're
is
swimming
moral nihilism
in it.
A bad thing?
Is moral nihilism a bad thing? Anybody here study ethics? My goodness. Well, then let me say this. If moral nihilism is not a bad thing, then there is nothing morally wrong with somebody causing you great harm right now.
Perhaps.
Or killing your family while you're here, or some other horrible thing.
Yeah, perhaps
so,
not.
So you agree with that? There's nothing morally wrong if somebody killed your wife and children while you were here in this debate?
I'm going to try to stop it. I don't agree.
But you don't agree it's morally wrong?
In a terms that you're using as being objective,
so it's not obligatory that people should not do that?
I'm not going to do that, but I can't tell you.
It's okay, I've got the answer I want. Okay. This is a moral nihilist we have here.
Oh.
So since we're almost out of time, it's worth noting, and we can talk about this offline because I don't want to take your time, I don't necessarily completely agree with Chris.
Yes, I was aware of that. I just didn't get a chance to get to you, Matt.
But if you'd like to debate morality sometime in another forum, we can do that.
Absolutely.
Thank you, gentlemen. We will move on to the next part of this round, and the no point of view will prevail, or at least have the 10
prevail.
Minutes.
Nice, unbiased moderator.
Oops.
Yeah, I'll start with something kind of simple. Mike had said that about this idea of the hiddenness of God. This is something I hear a lot. I realize that I don't know exactly where the default position would be. Should a God reveal itself absent a reason not to, or should a God hide itself absent a reason to reveal itself? But what you posted up there was this notion I've heard several times before, and that is that God will reveal himself to anybody who sincerely seeks. So I apologize. This is something that I find just so damn defensive that I had to respond right away. I find that difficult to believe, and I am wondering what your take is on this, because as somebody, I can't imagine anybody who more sincerely sought this revelation that you claim is common than I did. So did I just not try hard enough all those years?
You were the one that began the debate tonight. Talking about, or your speeches anyway, talking about bias and not being really aware of our bias and that sort of thing. That's what this point is making, that there is a subtle sort of bias that can be there, that we may even say, you know, we're seeking God, but our heart really isn't open to being totally submissive to him, submit to him. That's at least possibly true. That's my point. And that would be a good reason why God won't force people like that against their will to come to him. He will make the evidence just enough, okay, so that if they really honestly want him, it will be sufficient.
Yeah, we're fine.
Okay. Michael, you had talked about, the absurdity. You know, has anybody here ever seen an argument where everyone agreed or thought it was true. And, you know, this is not how you measure a good argument. This is not how good arguments are measured. But I think there are some. I think there are cases. You said they don't exist out there and whatnot. But I believe, as an argument, that if I open my fingers, this pen is going to fall onto this table. And I think I can garner universal agreement in that argument right now. Is there anybody who doesn't think the pen will hit the table? Without interfering? See, these are the epistemic parameters we have to get so clearly stated in the first place. Is there anybody in this room tonight who believes when I open my fingers, this pen will not fall and hit this table? Anyone? Zero. Universal agreement.
Yeah, Zeno, that's right.
So, Mr. Horner, you said it's highly unlikely, right, that we can garner this kind of universal acceptance, but we can. We can do it all the time. This is just merely one example. We can garner all kinds of other types of universal agreements.
Actually, it was Paul who said that. I'm going to let him respond to it directly. Okay. But I do want to make the point that I was trying to make about that, is that you do not need arguments at that level in order to have a good argument. Most of what we know is not to that high level of certitude as that conclusion.
But it's still probability. You would agree with David Hume that this is still probable.
That is still probability.
There is a chance, a quantum chance that goes right through the table.
Which is exactly my point. All arguments are probabilistic in nature, and some are better than others. And the three we're presenting tonight, I think, show it's highly probable that God exists. And all they need to show is that it's more probable than the denial.
And what do you use to measure probability? We can use...
Paul?
Yeah, Paul, we can use Bayesian systems. We can use all kinds of different probability measures. But how do you do it with a supernatural agent?
Can I get back to what you said at the beginning? I think you've actually switched the rules of the game here with your illustration about gravity. What you've shown is there are some positions, and I thought of that very one. And in fairness to you, it's true, we need to admit, there are some viewpoints on which you get universal agreement, and then that's probably one of them. But there's precious few, and as a matter of fact, what your point was, that if an argument is good, if it's valid, then you will get universal agreement. That's what you had said earlier.
Not just valid, but sound.
Sound. If that argument is sound, true premises, the conclusion follows, then you will get universal agreement. Well, I can show you many, many different places. How about something even as obvious as the shape of the Earth? There still is a flat Earth society out there. Does that mean that the arguments for the shape of the Earth are unsound because there's a flat Earth society? There's some people who don't believe it. Would you really be willing to say that? The fact that I can take something like the shape of the Earth and I can find one guy who doesn't believe it. Therefore, we no longer have a good argument for the shape of the Earth. In other words, you're saying that my point was, it's the wrong way to measure an argument. To simply ask, does everybody accept it? You don't. That's not how you measure. And I don't think either of you really believe that is how you measure a good argument. You measure it by the truth of the premises and whether the conclusion follows.
But everybody could see the universality of the soundness.
You have. There are some.
You're talking about the most important thing. I'm talking about a pen. You're talking about the most important thing in the universe. Why wouldn't that be as sound? Well, at least, if this is the greatest being we can possibly see, this is a pen.
Yeah, there's all kinds of reasons.
Right?
Yeah,
why wouldn't arguments for the greatest
about pens,
being in the
we're talking
universe
about pens, you're talking
be
about,
far more convincing than that? I just don't understand.
Well, look, there's a whole bunch of reasons why they might not be convincing.
Really? Where are they?
Michael was getting at one which Matt seemed to be having some difficulty with, and I can relate to that. I mean, I've puzzled over this many times. Why isn't it that if there was a God there who had forced himself upon people, you know what theologians have called that? Divine coercion, and God will not force himself upon people.
No, that would be called divine absolute truth.
Yeah,
right?
That's divine, convincing. Truth is one thing, and being convinced of it is another.
No. This idea that God is forcing himself on people is nonsense, because all I'm asking is for a demonstration that he actually exists, the same revelation that other people have claimed that they've received. I'm not asking anybody to force anything on me. And by the way, if the God of the Bible appeared before me tonight and demonstrated with all certainty possible that he actually exists, it doesn't mean for one second that I could or would worship it. So he's not in any way imposing himself upon me by demonstrating that he exists.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. And I'm fully in
agreement. Come to the side of the table.
I'm fully in agreement with that. God will not do it. It is nonsense to think he will do that. The only question is, and it's maybe something we won't know, why aren't the arguments for God's existence? Why doesn't he make himself more known? That's one thing we can worry about. But the question is this. Arguments have been presented, and what you need to do is to show how those arguments fail. Yeah. Is there a premise that's wrong? Is there a conclusion that's wrong?
That's what you need to do. We're about out of time. First of all, this idea that I've already forgotten what you just said. I apologize. I'm going to assume that I had something very profound to say in response. On one of the premises, this idea that something can't come from nothing. Really quickly, exactly how was that determined? When was there a nothing that we were able to determine was impossible? It was impossible for it to produce a something. I want to know what the demonstration is for that. Because to me, it seems like more one of those just-so stories that we intuitively accept.
You're right. It's a metaphysical intuition. And I noticed on your website, Iron Chariots, or that you're associated with, there's actually a very good article in there on knowledge by intuition. It's very well written, obviously by an atheist who believes in exactly that type of knowledge, direct awareness of some things. And this is one of those things. It's a metaphysical intuition that nothing comes from nothing. And by nothing here, we mean non-being, complete non-being. Nothing cannot come out of, or something cannot come out of non-being.
Do we know that there ever was or could be a nothing? If we don't know that there ever was or could be a nothing, then not only does
yes,
that make
yes,
any...
Yes, we do. Yes, we do? According, if we mean nothing, yes. That's what the Big Bang model tells us.
No. Nothing in the philosophical sense is a little different from nothing in the physics sense, and you can listen to Lawrence's talk on Sunday for that.
Well, I'm ready to respond to Lawrence.
Okay. Are you in here?
The Big Bang requires that there was nothing beyond the universe except something to cause it. And that would have to be an immaterial, timeless, extremely powerful being and would go to the attributes of God.
Did you just say nothing except something?
Beg your pardon?
Did you just say nothing except something?
Gotcha. I did say that. Allow me to clarify. The Big Bang is talking in terms of nothing when it comes to space, time, matter, and energy. There was nothing else like that. The only type of something there could be would be something that doesn't have any of those attributes, space, time, matter, and energy. So that's what we're talking about. That's where it requires a something that is not made up of space, time, matter, and energy.
Okay. We're talking about the abstract of almost a deus kickstarting the universe, because you think a deity must have necessary being, that it always existed forever and for all time. That's God.
That's our time.
Well, not forever in time. No.
No. God existed. Came into being?
God existed timelessly without the universe, and then I believe chose to exist in time since the universe, so that he can interact with his creation.
Thank you. Our time is up for that part of the program. I have to confess that I wasn't really sure whether the pencil was going to hit the table, but I didn't want to seem ignorant, so I just kept my mouth shut. Thank you very much. Well debated. I think this would be a good time just to thank our debaters for what they told us tonight. And thank you for listening. We will now move to the Q&A part of the evening. And what we're going to do is this. We've got two microphones, one on my left, one on my right. And in order to keep things moving back and forth, I will see how this works. If those who want to ask a question to the yes team would line up to the microphone on my left, and those who wish to ask a question to the no team, use the microphone here. And this is not... Are we not surprised at who's lining up at the microphone there? This is not a time for speeches. If you don't mind, it's a time for questions and getting answers. So the guideline is going to be, and these aren't going to be rigorously timed, I'm just going to try and keep track here at the podium, and interrupt when I need to, but if you could keep your questions to 30 seconds, the team that has asked the question will have up to 2 minutes to answer. the team that the other side of the debate will have 1 minute to respond to the question that was asked to the other team. So I hope we've got that right. So we will begin on this microphone on my left with your question.
All right, thank you. I believe it was Michael Horner that said that the world is all about probabilities, and if God is more probable than improbable, then God is true. They also say, the yes side says, that atheists who think there is no evidence for God, they're actually agnostics. When you say that God is probable, are you not yourself then an agnostic?
No, not at all. The argument that that I gave, let's just take the first one. Whatever begins to exist must have a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause, and then I drew some attributes out of that. That's a deductive argument, but we don't know the premises with absolute certainty. So that means that the conclusion is not known with absolute certainty. But it is still, if the premises are true, then the conclusion is true, because it's a valid argument. Certainty, probability has to do with how much certitude we have towards something that is true. And so it follows that we have in that argument a good argument that shows that it's highly probable that God exists, more probable than he doesn't, because the premises are more probably true than their denials. And so the conclusion is as well.
Does the no team have a response?
Maybe. So, briefly, we can believe things to different degrees of certainty. And I don't use the justified true belief for knowledge, and I know it'll probably irk some people that I have my own, but I talked to Chris about it earlier, and that is that we can believe things at varying degrees of certainty, some of them possibly absolute. But I define knowledge as a belief to a degree of certainty sufficient that to discover it was wrong would be absurd and world-altering, because we don't need absolute certainty. We don't operate based on absolute certainty. My question, though, is that, or my issue with this is that somebody who believes something a little bit may believe something and not actually be in a position to claim that they know it, which would definitionally still be agnostic.
Thank you. We'll move over to this side. A question for the no team.
Yeah, first of all, I just want to thank both parties here. I really appreciate just the respect that you have and that we can have open dialogues like this. And my question kind of flows out of that. Tonight we talked a lot about being able to ask questions and being respectful of people and tolerant. And I want to know what you guys think about guys like Richard Dawkins, who just last month encouraged atheists to ridicule and mock anyone who's not. How would you guys respond to that?
I'm gonna go ahead. I might disagree. I was actually not terribly impressed with Richard's speech at the Reason rally. I thought it was somewhat weak, and I thought the idea of ridicule can be used. I just don't know if it's our number one tact that should be incorporated in discussions about things that matter so much to people. The way I look at dealing with differences of opinion, especially when it comes to these important questions that we can ask ourselves, is that there is a spectrum of behavior in critical thinking. I very much admire what Richard Dawkins does, because he does it better pretty much than anyone else. He goes for the throat. And there are people like that, but there are people who don't go for the throat. And sometimes it is necessary to use satire. And sometimes it is necessary even to use ridicule. I just don't know if those have to be the primary sources for dialogue and discussion.
But would you want a theist to use the same ridicule with you?
They do.
It's often.
This is actually partially the subject of my talk tomorrow, and that's all I'll say.
Yes, team?
Well, I was just going to say I appreciate Christopher's comment there. I find ridicule gets us nowhere, and I know that some Christians ridicule atheists. Sounds to me like some of you have experienced that. I find that pathetic. Whenever I hear it, I condemn it, and I think we ought to condemn it. It's certainly not the way of Jesus. It was the one who told his followers to love not just your friends but your enemies too, to respond nonviolently to violent attacks. And Jesus is the revelation of the God that I believe in, but I haven't argued for it tonight because that was not the point of the debate. But when I hear anybody doing it, whether a theist or an atheist, I think it doesn't further any good dialogue, any discussion. It doesn't elevate humanity or human beings at all. And I think that I guess I'd probably be in agreement, Christopher, with your comment on that.
All right, we'll go back to the yes question side.
Hi, you talked about probabilities and that the existence of God is more probable than not. To extrapolate that, what then is the probability that homosexuality is bad? What's the probability that Jesus died for your sins? What's the probability that it's okay to beat your children? What is the probability that people should be killed for not going to church? It's all in the Bible, in case, I'm sure you've read it. But. So, it seems to me that there are probabilities about all these things, and yet people like yourselves, maybe not you, but other Christians, try to enact laws that condemn things like homosexuality.
Okay, now we're into a speech.
I'm done.
So I'm not sure if I understand the question. Are you asking why should we believe it? Or like, what's your connection between probabilities and laws? I don't understand your point.
Well, if it's only probable that God exists, then it's only probable that his laws are true.
Well, I think to say it's only probable that God exists is not exactly exactly right. It's just that my certitude is at a level that's below certainty. But that's just the way we know most things. Even science. Science is all about probability. So it is highly more probable that God exists. And if God gave commands, then those commands are certainly true. Whether we have correctly interpreted his communication to us would be something at question. But if we have correctly interpreted his communication, then we have God's commands, and they would be absolutely true. But there would be a degree of probability. I believe that God exists. Say 99%. Well, then I guess it would follow that I believe that that's a command of God. 99%. That's pretty good. I mean, that's just the way the world is. I didn't make this up. This is the way the world functions. We have to come to grips with it. I can't believe that you're attacking Christians for admitting that we don't know things with certainty. There's hardly anything we know with certainty. And by the way, that example of dropping the pen was not an example of something we knew with certainty. Christopher changed the language. Something we could get universal agreement on is very different than something we know with certainty. He admitted it was probabilistic, which was exactly my point.
Thank you. I think that's roughly 2 minutes. Response from no side?
I really don't get the idea of using the term probability when it comes to God. There's a probability that X number of us are going to be injured in car accidents over the next 10 years. Actuaries figure out what the likelihood is of certain types of, you know, injuries and deaths, and that's how it determines what your premiums are and that sort of thing. Probability in the existence of God, to me, is an incredibly nebulous term because it has no teeth. You're referring to something on a supernatural level for which we would need something akin to a reality measuring stick, which we do not have. Therefore, you cannot state the probability of the existence of a God.
Thank you. And over here, a question for the no team.
First of all, the back channel has been terribly entertaining today, and I'm glad that PZ doesn't have access to kittens. On to my question. If the universe is only material, then free will is illusory, and our choices are determined by our chemistry, our biochemistry. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay.
Go on.
You.
There's nothing like coming into a debate on the existence of God and turning it into a debate on free will, but come on.
All right.
This is going somewhere.
If our choices are determined by our biochemistry, then how can one worldview be considered more rational than another worldview?
Because they're more probable? That's, to me, that's just the point. To me, that's the biggest fear of religion, social sciences, law, and so on, is that the more we find out about ourselves, the more free will seems to be illusory, and that scares the hell out of a lot of people because they do think that it's a matter of moral nihilism and we're all done for and that sort of thing. The fact of the matter is, we robots have been able to peer inside of our mechanisms, and we know what makes us tick in a lot of ways, and we're finding out more and more what makes us tick. So perhaps in some ways, if free will is illusory, the idea of it still allows us the comfort to act in ways that we happen to value. The talk I'm going to give Sunday morning addresses that very question, by the way.
And quickly, because the question was about how do you determine which worldview is correct, I think free will and all of that is irrelevant to it. The only thing way to determine the correct worldview is consistency with the evidence of reality. That's it.
Yeah, see, the question was very, very astute, because if there is no free will, that means that our beliefs are determined, and what we think, you know, our rational process that we're doing and looking at the evidence is nothing but chemical reactions that are producing the beliefs. There is no rationality if there is no free will, and if determinism is true. You are determined to believe atheism is true. I'm determined to believe Christianity is true. There really is no rationality at all once you get rid of free will and determinism takes over.
Over to that microphone for
Chris. Okay. So I'm just here to stand up for the science, because what I heard over here on this side was a couple of theologians making a mangled mishmash of
neither
physics.
Of us are theologians. We're both philosophers, by the way.
Okay. Okay. Well, a couple of philosophers totally screwing up the physics. I wish Lawrence Krauss were here to tell you a few things.
Hello, Dr. Krauss. I know who you are. Thank you.
I'm not Dr. Krauss. But here's the thing. You know, the core of your argument was basically physics. You were saying, oh, is he here? Good. Is he gnawing? Good. Anyway, so the core of your argument was physics. The Big Bang, fine-tuning, so forth. You know, the Big Bang was determined to universal agreement among informed people by the use of evidence, mathematics, observations, things like this.
So that
like
would
this.
Be your preamble.
That's my preamble. Here's the question. Now, as philosophers, I would expect you to be competent in answering this one. You made this great, gigantic, logical leap from the Big Bang to claiming that it was a personal, intelligent being who caused it all. You didn't bother to mention, but his name is Jesus. Could you possibly give me any mathematical, physical, evidential reason that that is true?
I apologize to Dr. Krauss, by the way, for misidentifying. The claim is that we made a huge leap from the Big Bang to a personal God. It wasn't a leap. I argued through the evidence and then deductions from the evidence. The evidence tells us that the universe was shrunk down to a point of infinite density, singularity. Space-time, matter, and energy came into existence.
That's not evidence. That's an assertion. It is not an evidence.
That's exactly what Stephen Hawking and Roger Penrose showed in 1970, that those four things came into existence simultaneously. So our universe came out of nothing, literally nothing. Therefore, there must be a cause. Now, this cause, since there was no space-time, matter, and energy, must be timeless and immaterial and spaceless. The only types of entities that can be timeless or immaterial are either a transcendent personal mind or abstract objects. We know that abstract objects, though, can't cause anything. So in order to cause the universe, this cause had to be a transcendent personal mind. So that conclusion was a deduction, not a leap.
So, hang on. Sorry, you can applaud for him. I didn't mean to stop you from that.
I'm done.
Okay. So, I love how you keep citing physicists who don't agree that with the conclusions you're drawing from their work. But what you said, and you asserted it here again, is that one of the things that can exist outside of space-time is this personal mind. I have no... I don't know, and granted, it's unfair of me to ask a question here because you're not going to get to answer it. So I'll just say, I don't see any justification for asserting that a mind can exist outside of a brain, let alone outside of space-time.
that we are in the perfect position for to sustain life. If we were 2% closer, we would freeze. If we were 1% further, or sorry, if we were 2% closer, we would be on fire. If we were 1% away, we would freeze. And it's the same with the ozone layer. If we were any thicker, we wouldn't be able to, no plant life would be able to grow. It's same with if it was too thin, our plant life would wilt away and we would be a large dust bin, for lack of a better word. So it was already said that it was the chance of this happening was 10 to the 10th times 123, times 123. So how is it possible that God doesn't exist if, these facts are in front of us?
One word answer. Luck.
I'll jump in that I don't have the information here, so it's somebody here can correct me, but this 1% answer that gets passed around among the apologists for the creation view, we are 1% closer. Quite frequently, the Earth is in an elliptical orbit. This Goldilocks zone, even if they got the numbers wrong, the fact of the matter is this perception of design and this everything's perfect, the anthropic principle, if things had been slightly different, but not so different that it was impossible for any life to form, there would be a process by which some other species would be sitting here now talking about how perfectly the universe was designed to fit them. This is a case of putting the cart before the horse.
No, I'm afraid Matt and Chris misunderstand this argument. This argument is about the origin of the universe.
I think we still have 1 minute.
I beg your pardon?
I think we still have 1 minute.
You've got a few seconds.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. I just wanted to add something, Michael, that you do realize there have been like 7 ice ages, right? And you do realize 65 million years ago an asteroid hit the planet and wiped out all the big lizards and that sort of thing, and mammals got their shot. And you do realize there was a bottleneck of human population in Africa, and if they hadn't have left and populated the world, we're not having this conversation. When I say luck, do not take that lightly. We are so freaking lucky, it's not funny to be here.
Now, I think there's a misunderstanding about this fine-tuning argument. We're talking about the origin of the universe and the conditions of the very early universe were just right, and if they weren't, no life would be able to exist. That's what the argument is, no life of any kind. We're not talking about whether life, in a particular species or anything. And in fact, in most cases, if there was a slight difference in any of these values, the universe would have self-destructed a long time ago. Now, I'm amazed that you actually would honestly say that chance is the best explanation for that. I mean, it's clearly your only explanation, but it's not the best explanation, it seems to me. If we were playing poker and every time the cards got dealt, I got a royal flush and you didn't, and it happened no matter who dealt over and over and over again, and you started complaining and I said, well, you know what? I'm just lucky. I don't think you would accept that and you'd probably stop playing.
Call this microphone one on my left and back for a question to the S side.
Gods were first invented to satisfy the most egregious examples of primitive man's ignorance. Why are there storms? Why is there lightning? Why is there plague? Why is there famine? And science has one by one provided better answers to those questions. And in doing so, it's forced God to retreat further and further back. And it seems tonight God has retreated to a point beyond all space and time and to some place beyond the beginning of the Big Bang. If this is so, why do you cling to your Christian death cult in which Jesus said, Luke 14:26, unless you hate your mother and your father, your brother and sister, and your wife and child, and indeed your own life,
unless you do all that, you can't follow me. Basically, you've
is
made
that,
a great...
Is that the question?
That's my question. You've made a great argument for God being completely unfalsifiable.
Okay, we'll get to the answer now, please. We have to keep moving.
Why Christianity? Why not just abandon it?
Why not just... Okay, that's an interesting question. You've got two or three things going there. First of all, with regard to Jesus' statement, if you read that in the other gospel, that comes up twice. I think it's in the book of Matthew as well. You don't find the word hate there. I've studied that in a fair bit of detail because I wondered about it too. That was a very common phrase at that time that simply referred, if you don't prefer one strongly over the other, then the word hate was sometimes used for that. Hating one, preferring the other, and that's what that means. That's what Jesus said. If you want to really talk about the teaching of Jesus, you're talking about one of the greatest moral teachers of all time, and most of us know that. Whether you're a Christian or not, most people I talk to say, I may not be a Christian, but don't get me wrong, I appreciate the moral teaching of Jesus. And you do know he was the one who said, love not just your friends, which is, I find, hard enough, but your enemies too. And turn the other cheek, do unto others you'd have them do unto you. And not because these things were brand new, but because they're awesome moral teachings. But let me think what you said about first. You're referring to the God of the gaps issue. That somehow, since science answers questions that maybe people used to say we need God to explain, therefore we need God to explain less and less and less, kind of the God of the gaps idea. This is a real misunderstanding. What the arguments that Michael has presented tonight give us good reason for believing there is a being out there, an infinite transcendent being, something to provide an explanation for a moral sense that we all understand, the existence of the universe, and the other things that Michael's talked about. And that's the question you have to ask. Unless you're willing to say something comes from nothing, then you need to answer the question, how did we all get here? If there was a Big Bang, how did that Big Bang occur? Are we willing to say something comes from nothing? If you're willing to say that, then be my guest. But the fact is, if you're not willing to say that, then you need to say there must be something out there immeasurably powerful and supernatural beyond this natural world that brought what we have here into being. That's simply the Christian position, and the Christian position is that God revealed himself in the person of Jesus 2,000 years ago. And that's why Christians are not Jews. They're Christians because they believe Jesus really was the revelation of God in human form. And there are lots of good reasons for that, but we weren't called upon to bring those tonight because the debate wasn't about Christianity.
I'll call time.
It was about theism.
So, quick response, I don't particularly find Jesus to be that great of a moral teacher, and you can go to ironchariots.org and read like a verse-by-verse deconstruction of the Sermon on the Mount that I wrote. But I also find this idea, whether it says hate or prefer, I really don't care. This idea that there's a being out there who would want you to prefer him to your own family is disgusting. What would a God need preference or deference? There's nothing we could do to or for a God. The idea that we could insult him or somehow empower him with our praise is absurd. And any God that is actually moral and that is actually advocating moral positions could do nothing more than assert that you love each other and don't give a damn about him.
Thank you. Now, we are running over time, and I'm told that we should wrap up in roughly 10 minutes from now, which will give us time to get in several more questions, but we'll keep it moving as quickly as we can and move over to microphone 2 for the no side. Question 2.
Hey, Matt. My name's Matt. How you doing? Nice to meet you.
It's a good name.
It is a good name. I just want to ask forgiveness if this gets a little personal. You said that no one that you know of has searched for God as much as you, or what was your exact statement?
I have a difficult time imagining anybody tried harder or was more sincere. I can't say that they weren't, but I find that difficult to believe, especially given that there are people running around claiming to have had revelations, and they're probably not all true, so we know some of them are false. Given that, I think we can determine what the probability is. But when I see people who I know did not go through what I went through in an attempt to find this truth, dancing around talking about how they got, well, all you got to do, and God just revealed himself, and then he helped me find my car keys. Bite me.
Okay, it was kind of a two-part question.
Okay. I'll retract the bite me for now. That wasn't directed at you anyway.
No, I find that very impressive because me personally, I can't honestly say that I've searched for God with all my heart. But it does say in the Bible that Jesus fasted for 40 days and prayed nonstop. I think that's a pretty significant search, and I'd just like to ask anyone to search their heart.
Could you ask up in this direction?
So I was.
Well, I'm asking the people here because we're all present.
So I was gonna just say that I already answered this because you had a two-parter and pass it on. You guys can beat me up if you want, but I'll pass it on in about 15 seconds. You believe that Jesus was God. He didn't have to search for God, so don't bring that 40 days up starving as an example of somebody's search for God. That's just an equivocation.
I was born baptized, raised a Catholic. I was an altar boy for 5 years. Never propositioned by a priest, just for the record. They were all good guys. Contemplated the priesthood around the age of 12, then biology kicked in and that didn't work out too well. But, so I've searched, you know what I mean? And I've done that in a genuine, honest manner. And I suppose if something were to happen to me, that's why I'm a good skeptic. I don't totally discount the possibility that there could be something beyond my understanding of the natural world, although I still believe it's going to be a part of the natural world, but nothing's happened. So it just makes more sense for me right now to get on with the business of living and try to figure out what we all have in common, whether it's Christian notions, Hindu, Muslim, whatever. If they're good ideas for humanity and other species, they're good ideas on their own.
Yes, response.
Even though you find this notion offensive, I don't think you should dismiss it so easily that you have searched for God enough and you haven't found the evidence persuasive enough. And therefore, when someone says, well, you must not be seeking hard enough or something like that, you are offended. I mean, I understand that. But remember, Matt, you started by saying there's bias. We always have to be careful of our bias. We're not always aware of our bias. It's at least possible that bias is there that you're maybe not aware of. And persuasiveness, you say, well, these arguments aren't persuasive to me. I've never been persuaded. Well, persuasiveness is person relative. It's not based just on the arguments themselves. The subject is involved in that. And I think people have to look at that more closely and honestly.
All right, thank you, sir. I hope that answered your question. Over to microphone one, a question for the S team.
All right, thank you. I'll try to make this quick. First, I can't help but point out that as far as like the previous questioner from the other side who was talking about determinism and how that's free will is a problem for atheists, religious people have the same problem because if a religious person believes that the reason that they're different from, say, I'm as an agnostic or non-Christian, I'm different from you. The reason I'm different is because God created me differently. That's the reason we're different. And we're not in control of those differences. That's God, supposedly, according to the belief. But my question is, if we were to assume that objective morality exists because God gives it to us, we look at within Christianity and there's just a whole pile of disagreement among right and wrong. It's not like everybody agrees on everything. What's the point of having objective morality if we can't even know what it is? Because clearly, even within Christianity, we don't. Or in other words, for us humans, how is not knowing objective morality any different than objective morality not even existing?
Well, I think the fact is that for the most part, we do know objective morality. I mean, that is the main response I usually get from atheists, not the response that Christopher's given tonight. The response that I've given is, look, you don't have to believe in God. We agree with you that morality is objective. It's wrong to torture kids for sport. The Holocaust was wrong. These things were wrong. We agree with you, and then they just said, we don't think you need God for it. So I don't get your question. People God. Do know that there is real right and wrong. We don't know every detail of it. We move away from it in our lives. We don't obey it all the time, but we do know it.
The point is, it seems rather pointless if we don't know. Why would to have objective morality, to even claim it exists if you don't know it? because you're no further ahead, unless everyone within Christianity who claims to be in communion with God, unless they all have the same morality, which is obvious that they don't. I mean, we have a bajillion different denominations. I mean, it's okay. Pointless.
Okay, this is
an interesting line of reasoning here. It seems to me, if I follow your logic, and actually, that's a fair question you ask. If I follow your logic, though, what you seem to be saying is if there was such a thing as objective morality, we would all agree on moral matters, and for sure Christians would agree. If God gave it to us and if it's objective. Now, the question, those are two different issues. I mean, the question, whether it's objective morality, I don't think there's a lot of debate about that. All of us at the table believe that. I mean, most of us in this room believe that. The only question is what explains it, okay? And we've said tonight, God does. We don't find anything else that does. But let me just say this. The fact that there's disagreement on moral matters, that does not prove there's no objective morality. And let me take a real striking case in our own country right now. We're way divided on the abortion question. We got many people who are passionate pro-choice.
You can answer the abortion question in about 10 seconds.
Yeah, more and others pro-life, but you know where those two agree? Both agree that it is wrong to kill persons, which is why a pro-choice person will deny that killing an unborn is a baby and a person, and the pro-choice will insist that you're killing a person and a baby, a pro-life, that you're insist that you're killing a person and a baby because there's a fundamental agreement on that point. And this happens all the way down the moral matters. When you study ethics, you find this all the way down the moral disagreements. You can almost always find the basic principles of agreement. And
all right,
that's
thank
what
you.
I think we all
thank you.
Agree on.
No side has a minute if they wish.
I agree with the implication of the questioner. And I'm not getting into a debate on abortion here at the last of the debate.
All right, thank you.
Hi there, my name's Jason. I just want some clarity from the atheists. I just wonder, can an atheistic worldview account for an action being morally right or morally wrong? And please explain your answer.
First, you'd have to buy my book. But then...
hey, I paid $10 to get in here. Better be free.
Here, for free. For free, Google superiority of secular morality, and you'll find the talk that I gave on it, but...
Or you can go to YouTube and watch my new ethics, a synthetic understanding of good and evil. Anyhow, coming to you live from Kamloops, it's the Matt and Chris Show.
Please answer the question.
Yes. Listen, in the book I talk about the T-hip law. Basically, the way I see value is that it's basically inversely proportionate to harm. So what you should do should be considered in light of the harm it generates. Now, harm is a kind of a relative term, but there are ways in which we can try to make determinations about what is more harmful than not. And when you determine that actions are more harmful than not, then there is an obligation. You can hold an account for an obligation that they ought not to be done. Is this absolute? Is this objective? I don't find that. What I do is I've come up with this basic tolerance harm inverse proportion law. So the more harmful an action is, the less tolerant I have to be of that action and then feel compelled to move against that.
And in the remaining 20 seconds, I would say that...
Well, actually, you don't have a remaining 20 seconds. Good.
Then I won't say a thing.
I'm getting under the gun for time here, so I want to keep moving. Does the yes side have a very short?
Yeah, absolutely. Sorry, I thought it wasn't our turn. Christopher, you're quite confusing. First of all, you deny that objective morality exists, and now you seem to be trying to give some sort of basis for it on the basis of harm. It's really hard to nail you down. It's hard to know what you believe. Yeah, you're a mystery, that's for sure. So you seem to be wanting to say that it's wrong to harm human beings, we should be helping human beings, but there's no more obligation to that than if you said, well, if you want this slime mold to flourish, then you should keep the temperature and humidity moderate. I mean, there's nothing moral about that. There's nothing moral about not harming human beings if human beings are just accidental arrangements of atoms, just another arrangement slightly different than slime, maybe more complex, but it doesn't mean that they're more valuable. And so you don't have any objective obligations again. And yet we all do know it is wrong to harm people. We're obliged to love people not harm them.
Thank you very much. I have to apologize to those who are still at the microphones because we are out of time for this part of the evening. We are going to ask our two teams to make a brief closing remark on the evening and keep that to about 3 minutes if you could. So we will begin with the yes team.
Actually,
my apologies. We go to the no team.
Thank you. In Carl Sagan's novel Contact, a character mentions that over 90% of the world believes in some type of God. Now, this has fallen considerably since the novel was written, but it's still, the numbers are quite high. And what this means, basically, is that in all likelihood, these people foster false beliefs. And not only do they possess false beliefs, but they rely on these beliefs to direct their lives. It's not as though I believe that there are 12 invisible elephants eating pink popcorn on the dark side of the moon, and that really doesn't affect, you know, how I think and how I function in reality. But for those who do have these metaphysical views, these supernatural views of the world, they do affect the way in which they behave. Now, let's not forget that one of the main differences between Mr. Horner and Dr. Chamberlain and myself is that they and I are separated in our worldviews by really only one God. For they, like me, are somewhat atheistic of all other gods. You don't hear them arguing for Quetzalcoatl, and you don't hear them arguing for Brahma and that sort of thing. It's a very specific Christian God. And even though there may be interesting and wonderful ideas found in many of the world's religions, not just Christianity, but in Judaism and Hinduism and Islam, these ideas would be wonderful with or without the existence of any particular God. And this is because some of these ideas are just good on their own. And humanists and secularists and skeptics and atheists don't necessarily need a sublime being looking down on us, patting us on the back when we do particular actions that we happen to value as a society, as a group, or as individuals. The central doctrine of Christianity is love, and the concept of forgiveness, I think, is an incredible turning point in human nature and human evolution. It's very difficult to forgive. You have a kind of visceral revenge type reaction often. There's a certain pragmatism of religious beliefs provided they do not interfere or curtail civil liberties and freedoms. But the problems emerge when there's a disagreement between specific aspects of how one looks at the world. Much of our nation's constitution was developed during a time when accepting a Judeo-Christian God was simply the norm. In God We Trust all appears on the coins and bills of American money. Reference to God appears in national anthems, pledges of allegiance, responses to sneezes, and acts of fortune. We won the World Series.
15 seconds.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, you're welcome.
Nice timing. But it also applies to misfortune. The tornado killed everyone but me. I guess I'm truly blessed. Now, I do not wish to say that our opponents' beliefs in God do not have positive personal and social effects. In fact, their beliefs are extremely Darwinian. I'll need about 20 seconds.
Well, that'll be 20 seconds more than you've got. I am going to ask you to wrap up in one sentence.
Okay. Basically, it is my intention this evening to demonstrate to you that the existence of our opponents' definitions of God is not only unlikely, but contradictory. And good actions, like good people, stand on their own merit without the approval of any God. Thank you.
And the yes team, 3 minutes.
Contradictory? That's the first time I've heard that tonight. That would have been a good thing to bring up a lot earlier and show us what is contradictory about the concept of God. That would be very important to point out because that would be a good argument for atheism. And that's been tried before. It's always failed. And I'd like to see you try it again because then you'd have an actual good argument for atheism right there. To bring it up now is pretty interesting, but I want to point out that came up right now. Not before. The other thing I find, Christopher, you just gave yourself away, and I appreciate the fact that you did that. I like what I heard there, because you made the statement just right now. Some ideas are good on their own. I agree with that. You know what that means? that you are just like me. You're not a moral nihilist after all. You recognize some things are objectively, morally good. And you know what? We all do. In this room, we do. I think, unless you are going to want to take that statement back. So which just means now the only question is for both of us, what explains that kind of objective moral value? I want to say this in tonight's debate. We've heard lots of shots taken at theism, all kinds of things. It's difficult to understand God outside of time, all that kind of thing. We don't quite get it. Those are all fair comments. What we have not heard tonight is even one attempt to make an argument to show us that atheism is true. And I think it's worth noting there hasn't been even one. Not even one. All there has been is an attempt to show us that theism doesn't succeed, and that somehow leads to the conclusion that atheism is therefore true. There are three answers to the questions of tonight's debate. Yes, no, and maybe. We've heard an argument for maybe, but not for no. And I think Mike has a couple things to add.
Right. The three arguments that I gave come down to some choices. The first argument comes down to which is more reasonable, to believe that a universe had a cause or that it popped into existence out of nothing, by nothing, and from nothing. I have no trouble knowing which is the more reasonable answer there. The second argument comes down to chance, as far as Chris is concerned, that even though you've got numbers like 1 to the power of 10, 1 out of 10 to the power of 10, the whole thing to the power of 123, he thinks that that's more reasonable to believe that something that improbable took place rather than a designer designed the fine-tuning of our universe. And the third argument, Christopher denied that morality is obligatory and objective, but what do we call someone who denies that it's morally obligatory to not torture toddlers for sport? What do we call someone like that? A psychopath. Now, I'm not saying that Chris is a psychopath. My point here is that he's not a moral nihilist like he says he is. He does think it's obligatory not to torture toddlers for sport. And so the argument, all three arguments stand as much more reasonable than the alternatives. And I think we've established our case for something very consistent with the Judeo-Christian God. We're well on our way to Jesus.
Thank you. That concludes our debate for this evening. Now, before I ask Ian to come up and formally thank the speakers, and I think he has an announcement or two as well, I personally want to thank them. This has been very instructive for me. I still don't have the answer, but I've got some damn good column material, so it's been very worthwhile. And thank you as well, and thanks to the organizers, and Ian.
Let's hear a round of applause for Mel. So thank you all for coming. That was a fantastic debate. I don't know if it changed many minds, but hopefully you had lots to think about. And if you're like me, you had lots of times where you're like, I wish I could say something to that, or I wish I could change that argument. Or not saying either of you were wrong, but. So if you're a moral nihilist like me and Chris, but you do hold a secular ethics, the BC Humanist Association might be your way to to make it all up.